Hi, and welcome to the Build Your Own Data Logger course, brought to you by FreakLabs and WildLabs. I'm Akiba from FreakLabs. This is Module 6-0, Ruggedizing Devices. In this module, we'll be taking a look at how to protect our devices from water, debris, and animals, and go through the different tools you'll need to do it. And just a note, for the components that we'll be discussing here, we'll also be providing links to them in our webshop. We work hard on locating suppliers for ruggedization components, so if you see anything you think is interesting, feel free to pick some up and try them out. The platforms and electronic components that we're using to build our custom hardware aren't usually purpose-built for the types of hostile environments we'll be deploying in. Devices like a standard Arduino or Raspberry Pi, although great platforms, are meant for lab or home experimentation. However, we'll need to protect our devices against bugs, literally, wild animals, potentially extreme temperatures, and rainfall. The good news is there's a few tricks that'll allow us to do this. We want to ruggedize devices because it factors into the device's lifespan in the field. Aside from battery life issues, the single most common failure in field devices is mechanical. When we say mechanicals, we mean anything besides the electronics that's physical, such as connectors, cables, enclosures, and any moving parts. Mechanical failures are often due to corrosion or exposure to the elements. In the image above, you can see a failed water level measuring device for rice paddies due to a bad seal in the enclosure. After getting caught in a thunderstorm in the Philippines, the device failed. So you can see that ruggedization is protecting the device against the elements to prevent mechanical failures. We can protect different areas of the device. In this video, we'll cover enclosures and protecting the bare circuit board. In the next video, we'll go through cabling, connectors, and protecting interfaces and visual indicators like push buttons and LEDs. We won't cover everything in detail. However, we'll go through some options and terminology for each. This will form a good starting point from which to further investigate how you can ruggedize your own devices. In this picture, you can see two ruggedized enclosures. They are completely sealed from water, and the connectors also have sealed caps. Any cables that connect to them will screw into them to prevent getting yanked out, i.e. from people tripping over them, monkeys yanking on them, etc. And will also have a waterproof seal in case they get caught in the rain. The most important step in protecting a field device is choosing the enclosure that's going to work in your environment. For example, enclosures that are deployed in marine environments will need to be submersible, withstand water pressure, and higher levels of salinity than those typically used on land. When selecting an enclosure, beyond considering things like size, mounting, and camouflage, you'll want to consider the level of water and debris resistance and look at the device's IP rating. We'll discuss IP ratings in more detail in the next slide. We'll also look at gaskets and seals, the materials the screws are made of, and protecting access points through latches or screws. Let's start out with the IP ratings. IP ratings are published by the International Electrotechnical Commission, or IEC, and indicate the enclosure's level of protection against solids and liquids. IP stands for ingress protection. As an aside, ingress means the act of going in or entering, or right or permission to enter. So ingress protection is a protection against something entering. IP ratings are often used to define industrial enclosures, since factories are often considered a hostile environment. However, rainforests, deserts, and locations with many insects and animals are also hostile environments, to hardware at least. In the IP rating system, the first digit of the number is the ingress protection for solid materials, i.e. dust and debris. For field devices, we generally require this to be the highest level of protection, which is 6. That means no dust or solids can enter, or that the device is completely sealed. You'd be surprised what kind of insects would nest inside a nice warm enclosure if there were accessible vents. The second digit refers to the ingress protection for liquids. For field devices, we generally look for between a level of 4 and 8, where 4 would be considered water resistant and 8 would be considered submersible. An IP68 rated device starts getting to military grade protection, although there's a separate spec called MIL standard for this. MIL standard goes beyond ingress protection, where devices are drop tested, tested for salt fog tolerance, gunfire vibration, air pressure tolerance, and resilience to extreme temperatures. We'll just stick with the IP ratings. At FreakLabs, for land deployments, we use generic, off-the-shelf IP65 rated enclosures. Off-the-shelf is useful because the enclosures are readily available and affordable, and we can swap them out easily if they're destroyed. A critical component of water resistance and waterproof enclosures is the gasket. A gasket is a steel sheet or a moldable ring which fills the space between two or more surfaces to prevent leakage. In our case, the gasket is a soft, moldable ring that fits into the enclosure lid to seal the enclosure base and lid. Because it's moldable, the gasket will conform to the shape and surface even if it's uneven. If there's no gasket, even if the enclosure is rated IP65 and the lid is closed tight, there will be micro gaps where water can seep in. So during intense downpours or flooding, there's a good chance water will still get in, causing problems. We usually have a gasket for any opening in the enclosure, such as the lid or around the holes where the cables or sensors come out to prevent water getting in. When purchasing bulk or wholesale enclosures, they may come without the gasket, and the gasket is available as a separate add-on. Cable glands are often used to seal the opening where cables come out, and usually come with a gasket. We'll cover cable glands in the next video. When we assemble the enclosures, we squish the gaskets in and glue it in place using rubber cement to prevent it from dislodging as the cover is removed. When a device is sealed for a long time, a common problem is the gasket gets pulled out when the device is opened. Hence, gluing the gasket in place saves a lot of headaches of constantly replacing or reinstalling the gaskets. The materials screws are made from affect how quickly the screws rust and degrade. Most screws are generally made out of bare steel, and these will oxidize and rust the quickest. Screws with a zinc coating are next best, as they won't rust or oxidize as quickly. However, over time, and especially in an environment where things may knock against the device, the zinc plating may come off. In those places, rust can form. At Freak Labs, we replace all the stock screws that come with the enclosures with stainless steel screws. Stainless steel screws are made out of a chrome steel alloy that oxidizes a lot less than the zinc plated screws and will last much longer in the field. In the top picture, you can see we placed bare steel and stainless steel screws in two trays underwater for a couple of days. On the left are the bare steel screws, which have already rusted. On the right are the stainless steel ones, which have no oxidation. If you're using enclosures with any exposed metal, such as a metal latch for access, you'll want to check the metal used to avoid rust as much as possible. It also depends on environment, where desert environments may have less danger of oxidation than humid tropical or salty coastal environments. Another factor to consider when selecting an enclosure is whether it's closed using screws or a latch. Usually, latches are just as water and debris proof as screws, so the main consideration would be usability. Latches are more expensive, however, it's much easier to open up a latched device than a device with screws. This is especially useful for swapping out SD cards, updating firmware, etc. The drawback is that it's also easier for other people to open. If you're in an area that has any kind of foot traffic, then you may want to prevent random people from opening up the device out of curiosity and potentially pushing buttons. We generally prefer using screws for closing up enclosures. They're lower in cost and also provide an additional deterrent from people randomly walking by and opening the case, although they're more cumbersome to open. We recommend having a battery-operated or rechargeable screwdriver handy in the field if you use these types of enclosures. It saves a lot of time and from getting sore wrists. Sometimes you'll need holes in the enclosure for things like speakers or microphones. We'll still want to water and debris-proof these holes, and we can do this by gluing special materials over them. There are some newish materials that are available for this. ePTFE is a fragile, membrane-like material that is microporous and will let air through, but not larger molecules like water. PTFE goes by the trade name Teflon, and ePTFE is expanded PTFE. It also goes by the trade name Gore-Tex, and is a common material used in waterproof, breathable fabrics. It's also the material used on water-resistant smartphones to protect the speakers and mics. It's quite fragile, and its breathability will decrease as it's handled more, since the material deforms and packs together. Another interesting breathable material is TPU, or thermoplastic polyurethane. Unfortunately, its trade name is also TPU, and is not commonly referred to except by product designers or plastics specialists. TPU is the material often used in smartphone screen protectors and athletic shoes for breathable water resistance. It's more rigid than ePTFE, so it's more rugged, but also stiffer. It's not good for clothing, but on an enclosure, they work out quite well. They don't deform as easily and can be handled more than ePTFE. We have both materials available in the Freak Labs webshop, in case you're interested, as well as many others. Feel free to test them out. Ruggedization is primarily a fight against water. Nowhere is this more true than on the actual circuit board. Depending on the conditions inside the enclosure, you may need to waterproof the board, especially in humid environments or if there will be excessive condensation inside the enclosure. If the board isn't in an enclosure and exposed directly to the elements, then you'll definitely need to waterproof it. This could be the case if you need a circuit that's as light as possible, hence it has no protective enclosure. To waterproof the circuit board, you can use a chemical waterproofing agent. Typically, this is varnish in its various forms. You can get spray varnishes specifically designed for PCBs, or use a liquid clear coat varnish paint. These are available at hardware stores or places for paint and woodworking. And finally, in a pinch, there's nail polish, or more specifically, clear nail top coat. Unfortunately, this is generally expensive since you'll be using quite a lot of it, and unless it's your top coat, whoever you borrow it from won't be happy if you return it empty. Before you varnish a board, please make sure the area is well ventilated and, of course, the board is unplugged. Not that we've ever made that mistake before. When varnishing, be careful not to varnish over any connectors such as where you might plug in a sensor or a USB programming dongle, the SD card slot, any moving parts, or anything that'll interface outside the PCB. This is because the varnish will prevent making good electrical contact between connectors and will impede any moving parts from moving. We also recommend putting a mask or stencil over the board or taping these parts before spraying or painting. Potting is another method of protecting electronics against not only moisture, but vibration and shock. Potting is when the circuit board is covered with a curing material such as epoxy, urethane, or electronics-grade silicone that then hardens, forming a protective casing. Potting is more involved and more expensive because it requires a mold. It's also fairly permanent. This means things like changing the circuit or updating the software will be extremely difficult unless it's encased with these considerations in mind. To pot your circuit board, you'll need some type of mold or form, and when using silicone, check that the curing agent is not acidic. This will potentially corrode the electronics as it cures. Another option to protect circuit boards that is becoming more viable is to use heat shrink tubing. In fact, some heat shrink is becoming so wide that it would more properly be called heat shrink hose. Heat shrink tubing is really nice because it's wide enough that it can completely cover the circuit board and provides an unbroken seal along its length. It also conforms to the shape of the electronics, creating a very light, compact layer of protection. Then, if you need to access the circuit board, you can easily cut off the heat shrink tubing and have access to the bare board again. One way to close off the ends of the tube is to add hot glue inside near the ends. As the tube is heated and shrunk, the hot glue melts and is forced to distribute itself around the tube, creating a potting layer which seals the ends of the tube. Of course, you can't access the bare board once this is done though, but it provides a robust protection for the board. If you're planning to access the board later, you can also just tape the ends to seal them. If the board uses visual indicators to indicate, for example, a board malfunction, then we prefer to use transparent heat shrink tubes as it allows us to see if any LEDs are blinking. If there's no visual indicators on the board, then you can just use whatever heat shrink tubing is available. What's also interesting is that one of the factors driving heat shrink tubing as a form of circuit board protection is lithium-ion polymer batteries. Lithium-ion polymer batteries use heat shrink tubing for protection, and as the battery sizes got bigger, people started considering them for use to enclose electronics as well. Just a note, if you're looking for a wide flat heat shrink tubing in both opaque and transparent materials, they're available at the FreakLab shop as well. A common problem people have with field devices is the insides of their enclosure building up condensation. This especially happens in hot, humid environments. One way to protect against this is to use silica gel pouches. You can also purchase reusable silica gel and put them into mesh pouches that go inside the enclosure. These will absorb excess humidity as long as the lid is closed and the box is sealed. We recommend reusable silica gel with a color indicator that shows when it is no longer usable. When this happens, you can toss them into a microwave and cook them until they return to their original color. That wraps up Module 6-0, where we've discussed selecting enclosures and different ways to protect enclosures and bare circuit boards from the elements. Coming up in Module 6-1, we'll discuss cables, including different types and families of connectors for cable harnesses, as well as protecting user interface components such as buttons and LEDs.